come with me through my lab. Watch the cables. I will say that it is an operating lab. My name is Firas Al-Tahan. I am the rail and transit lead for British Columbia at Stantec. I manage a transit planning team, a systems engineering team, and a rail design team. I joined Transport for London in 2006, my graduate scheme straight out of university, and I've been focused on London Underground, East London Line rail projects for the first 7 years of my career with TfL, and focused on control systems, project delivery, stakeholder engagement, working with contractors. So my entire career has been within rail and transit, starting in London Underground. So firstly, welcome to the lab. And this all ties in with the yard control system. Super excited by having the opportunity to put this all together, both the lab, the control system, the liaison with the clients. And what this tool does, what this project is all about, is fundamentally trying to drive safety and efficiency for our clients. The yard control system looks to manage the safe movement of trains in a rail operating environment. Before any of this technology, the operator would get out of their cab and walk over, take a minute or two walking over in the rain or in the cold or in the snow, and they would go to their switch and they would pull the lever, just like in the cartoons, and walk back into their vehicle and drive through it. And they would validate themselves through what we call in the industry line of sight. They would drive just like you drive your car. Is it safe for me to drive at 30, 40, 50 kilometers an hour, miles an hour? Yes, I'm going to continue at that speed because I can visibly see it's safe for me to do that. The value proposition with respect to the technology that's being offered is the opportunity to have this wireless device around the yard, around the field, around the maintenance facility, around the food and agriculture industry. If you have a rail network, if you have a rail yard or a facility, it's entirely feasible to have this wireless device actually on board the vehicle, on board the train. And for the train operator to be requesting the routes in advance of them reaching the junction. There are natural efficiency gains to be had straight away because it takes a while to re-rail a train or re-rail a vehicle. People rush. Remember, some of these sites are 24/7 operation. And so people are coming back at 5 a.m. having done an 8-hour shift or a 7-hour shift in the field, in the cold, in the rain. They're tired. Did I throw the switch properly? Am I looking down, is it in the right line for the route I'm going to take? And these things happen. What we've developed is the glue that holds it together, that talks with the axle counters, that talks with the interlocking here, and presents to an operator, wherever she or he may be, the scenario and the conditions and the context of what's happening in the field. That hardware and software implementation is able to remotely, even wirelessly, request the routes of the system. So in theory, with that hardware and software implementation, you don't need the panels in the field anymore, because someone who's walking around the field can remotely request those routes. A key output here, a vital output in fact, would be to a circuit that actually powers the motors that engage the switch. The entire piece is completely remotely controlled and power operated. The key components of the yard control system, in essence, track trains, the movement of trains across a geography. We rely upon technological axle counters or wheel detectors, and you've installed these detectors on either side. If you count the same number of wheels go in and the same number of wheels go out, you've proven that that block is now clear, because the count coming in has been counted out. You're left with no extra counts in that block. Tried and tested technology, validated to all the safety requirements that are available within the rail and transit industry. The axle counter system tells us about block occupancy across its region through Ethernet. The typical rail industry proven way is through a ton of cables. And so a ton of cables and relays. I'm not going to go into relays today, but one cable tells us everything we need to know about the block occupancy of a geography. And so from an efficiency, from a maintainability, from a test perspective, it's so elegant. The yard control system is a system that's matured that ticks a lot of boxes for the variety of stakeholders that use, live and breathe this, the maintainers, the operators, the project managers who are putting this in, the safety people who are validating that the technology that we're putting in place here, that the processes and the equipment that we're putting in the field is demonstrably safe. We're using the technology behind me, which is the baseline product for freight control systems. The freight industry, the class ones across North America use this, and this is widespread. Where it isn't widespread is in the transit world. And so what the team are doing are bringing designs that are tried and tested in freight, but bring it into transit. And the primary application is the manual operation. And so we're driving that level of safety and efficiency, as we say, by bringing in these control systems that are proven, tried and tested. In rail signal and in rail control, we want absolutes. Because if you get it wrong, trains will derail. Now, in the yard control system, we're dealing with vehicles that are doing tops 10, 15 kilometers an hour. So the severity of that worst case scenario isn't so high. But the reason we don't like to use GPS, some technologies use GPS, but it's not the be all and end all of it, is because we want to be able to make those safety related decisions on data and inputs that we can trust. This equipment here we can trust. We can trust because all the safety assurance has been provided, it's documented. GPS, there's no safety validation whatsoever. We can't go to NASA and say, hi, can you write us a certificate so that we can make safety critical decisions? They're not going to give you that whatsoever. So what that means is you need to make up for it by making the system more complicated. One huge benefit is the benefit of engaging EITs, the younger generations who've never been involved in a lab like this before, who haven't got their hands dirty with this. They've seen the theory, they've done the numbers, they've done the calculations, but how often do they get to do wiring like this and to actually play with the equipment behind me? It really does engage and drive people, and I've found that the vast majority of my team come into the office routinely because of this lab and what opportunities it brings for them to play, do R&D, and test software and hardware solutions. Okay, so let me take you to the other part of the lab, which in essence is the development part for the software. I pushed the team to really push hard and see where they can take the technology. How could they innovate? And in respect to a strong graphical user interface that enables touch and real kind of engaging UI, I thought that the iPad would be a great way forward. What we're seeing here is the geography that the yard control system is protecting. We see here three switches, switch 84, switch 85, and switch 50. The arrows with the lines represent the routes. What that represents is an operator has come in, they've requested a route, the safety layer has validated that everything is in line for that route to be offered. As I push the developers to make this scalable, to make sure that they don't assume the first project is going to be as far as it needs to go. It's all well and good making the software operate to the first project, but I didn't want to make it too arduous to expand it to a bigger network, more switches, more track segments. If this geography were quadrupled in size, it wouldn't bat an eyelid. Prior to having the lab, we started it during COVID, I think it was 2021, probably February, March time 2021, and we just occupied the desks. And that was great because there were very few people in the office. It was like having an entire office block to yourself, to anyone who wanted to come into the office. But then when people started coming back, I made a case for the lab, and fortunately, touch wood, the leadership supported it. One of the benefits of having a lab like this is that we're able to give space for people to concentrate and develop and actually test the entirety of the software and hardware, where they can concentrate and focus on writing the code, on validating. So we can't have switch machines here, but we can simulate all the lamps, we can simulate the contacts that make or break within the switch machines that feed the I/O. We've invested considerable capital in order to populate this with all the equipment that we need to do the wiring, soldering, and it's really reaping the rewards for the team, our clients, engagement, and it really is a big win for us. I'm delighted. The test panel enables us to test and to demonstrate and to simulate every piece of I/O that's coming out of this noisy power supply and fan. We're able to test every line of configuration that we're making to the interlocking here. And as part of our validation process, we're able to create test scenarios and to try and break the system. We want to break the system here in this lab before it goes anywhere near the railway. So we're going to be doing what's called a factory acceptance test here in this lab. We have all the hardware that's a complete simulation, that's a complete one-to-one mirror of what's going to be put in the field, all paid for out of Stantec's pocket. There's a scheme called the Stantec Greenlight scheme. It's a bit like a mini dragon's den. And we make a pitch to some senior leadership, and we say to them, hey, listen, we have this idea, and this is an idea that we believe in our leveraging our expert opinion, would resonate with a client. The idea would cost this, the investment will give us this, and we went through that scheme and got two rounds of funding, in fact. Not just one round, we got two rounds of funding. The process was made much, much simpler by virtue of the fact that we'd already secured a notice to proceed with our client. That provided confidence to the leadership that this was an idea that they should be investing in because our clients were investing in it. So we got that funding, and what that funding allowed is, one, for us to invest in some of the equipment that you see behind me, and two, it actually got some of the leadership engaged. So it's quite a unique selling point for us. We're able to promote this lab and the scheme, the Stantec Greenlight scheme, as, hey, listen, you know, Stantec have invested serious capital in this. And it invites confidence. That's what it does. It says, hey, listen, this team are securing capital. This team are delivering. This team I can trust. I'm very appreciative of how this entire journey has come along. We're able to say, of course we can do your designs. We've got all the equipment here. We're able to test it here before it goes anywhere near you.